صلى الله عليك يا أبا عبد الله، يا رحمة الله الواسعة، ويا باب نجاة الأمة، يا غريب مظلوم كربلاء. In the world of love and tears, I find Zahra is my mother. Her love guided me to the truth in this life and the hereafter. Her broken rib exposes the true path and her oppressor. All cries for justice learn from her cry between the wall and door. I saw her tears as a sign. I saw her tears as a sign that only love can define, because the hearts cannot find truth till they fall in love with her cries and her tragedy. It touched the soul within me till I knew I shall cling to her till death. Till I knew I shall cling to her till death, till the hereafter. Do not ask about the tears. Do not ask about the tears that are shed from a broken rib. No doubt shedding tears for Fatima is in itself worship. In her lovers is a fire. In her lovers is a fire that is never extinguished. We cry because to be alongside our mother we have wished. We cry because to be alongside our mother we have wished. We wish that we were with her when the door crashed upon her. Was she not tortured enough? Ya Zahra, was she not tortured enough by the death of her pure father? And Haidar was forced to watch as his wife was hit with sword. So don't ask about our tears when her blood is flowing rivers. So don't ask about our tears when her blood is flowing rivers. Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Wa sayalamu alladhina zalamu ala Muhammadin ayyamun qalabin yanqalibun. Wal aqibatu lil muttaqin. Nawru majalisikum bi dhikri salati ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. قال الله الكريم في كتابه الحكيم: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الذين ينفقون في السراء والضراء والكاظمين الغيظ والعافين عن الناس والله يحب المحسنين. آمنا بالله، صدق الله العلي العظيم. أفلح من صلى على محمد وآل محمد. A young child comes to his father one day. A young child who has a problem comes to his father one day. He says, Father, I have a problem. The father says, what is the problem? The child says, I'm angry all the time. I can't express my emotions enough. I can't hold these emotions. I'm angry all the time. Father, what do I do? The father looks at his son and he says to him, do you see that fence over there? There's a fence. You see that fence over there? You see this hammer and this nail? Every single time you get angry, pick up this hammer, pick up a nail, and smash a nail into the fence. So after a day, the first day, the child hit 37 nails into the fence. How many? 37 nails. So that means he was angry at something or the other 37 times. Hit it in the fence 37 times. The first day, the second day, the third day, fourth, fifth, the numbers decrease. First day was 37, second day was 30, third day was 25, 20, 15, until after 1 week, the child returns back to the father and says, Father, I have good news for you. Father says, what's the good news? He says, for a whole day, one whole day, I haven't hit a nail into the fence. The father says, well done. But the father looks at his child and he says, you see that fence over there? The child says, yes. He says, all of the nails that you pierced into the fence, I want you to take each one out. Every single nail you've nailed into the fence using that hammer, take each and every single one of them out. The child says, why? The father says, just do as I'm telling you, and I'll tell you why. So the child comes to the fence. After about an hour, he takes all of the nails out. Until finally he comes to the father and says, Father, I've taken all the nails out. What exactly do you want me to do? What exactly are you trying to say? The father says, well done for overcoming your anger. But you see this fence, how many holes it has? How many holes does the fence have? The child says, I can't count them. There's more than 100 holes. He says, Father, he says, child, every single time you're angry, you're showing your anger to someone. And therefore you're hurting this person. This person may have forgiven you. He may have said to you, okay, it's fine. But that hurt is still left in him. That hurt is still left in him. That nail that you've pierced in him is still there. The mark is still there. And it's the same thing with the fence. Every single time the child used to put a nail into this fence and takes it out, he sees the hole there. Today, inshallah, something which I've noticed within this community, especially with the Iraqis, anger is something which is prevalent and they can't do something about it. The fathers are always angry. They've always got something to talk about. Oh, I'm angry about this. And they start to swear and swear and swear. The child, obviously seeing his father, will take on after him. So the next generation is seeing this and not doing anything about it. So today, inshallah, just a couple of words on anger in four stages, inshallah. What does science say about anger? You know, every single time I go to college, into school, the physics and the biology and the chemistry and everything, science has an option. Science has something to say about anger. Obviously, it's sociology and psychology, but what does science exactly say about anger? What happens to the human being when he is angry? Secondly, what does Islam say about anger? What happens to a person if he's angry? His mental being. What happens? Does he do a sin if he's angry? Does he not do a sin if he's angry? All of these actions, Islamically, I'd like to look at that as well. Thirdly, if we are an angry person, how do we overcome this anger? This anger that we have inside us. How do we overcome it? What steps can we take? What practical steps can we take to overcome this anger? Now I can give you hadith and hadith and hadith from Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, Imam Hussein, Imam Ali alayhi salam. I can give you hadith from the Prophet that says, you know, anger is wrong, anger is wrong, anger is wrong. For some reason or the other, we don't seem to take that into consideration. So inshallah, I will try to look for another way and look for practical methods of how to overcome anger. How did the infallibles, the holy 14 Imams, how did they overcome anger? They were normal human beings. Of course, infallible human beings, but they still had emotions. Just because they were human beings, just because they were infallible, doesn't mean they had emotions. And fourthly,
I shall look into the role of Fatima Zahra and the Prophet. And when the Prophet released that famous hadith, Fatima is a part of me. Whoever angers her, angers me. Inshallah, those four steps, we can overlook anger in complete depth. Salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Science says that when a person is angry, there is something called the intellect, our mind. When a person is angry, they make loud noises. They make themselves look big. They bare their teeth. Their face changes. They stare sometimes. Science says these are the characteristics of someone who is angry. However, when an animal is angry, he also does the same thing. An animal also makes himself look big. An animal also changes his face. An animal also makes his loud noises. Animal also stares. Ever seen when a lion is angry, he stares? An animal also does the same thing. So what's the difference between a human being who shows anger and an animal who shows anger? They're both the same exact same thing. The main and important focal point is that when a man or a human being loses, when a man becomes angry, he loses this. He loses his mind. He loses the only thing that differentiates between an animal and a human being, the intellect, the mind. When a man is angry, science says that it's a response, it's an emotional response to something. It's an emotional response, at least someone's listening. It's an emotional response to something. When a man is angry, either his life is in danger, his safety is in danger, someone has said something about his honor, his health, his wealth. Something is wrong with this human being. Therefore, he feels that he has to express his emotions and make sure that whatever he feels inside, he has to tell someone. Now, the word anger in the Arabic language is kadhab. The reason why it's called kadhab, or in Arabic, it's like a flask of hot boiling water or tea. You have to put a cover on it, but the longer you keep the cover on, the hot boiling water cannot withstand inside it. So for example, a kettle, the more you boil the water, the more steam comes out. If you were to put a lid on this cover, what would happen to this kettle? It would burst. This exact same thing with a human being. He has so much emotions, he feels so angry about something that he has to let it go. He has to reveal these emotions. Now when you reveal these emotions, you are affecting someone else. Now what people fail to understand is that us as human beings, we have our own individual personality. But what we fail to understand is what we are living in a society, we are interacting with people every day. You live with your brother, you see your friends in school, your mother, your father, your uncle. You live with people every single day. They also have their own individual personality. They have their own character, something which annoys them, something which makes them happy. Everyone is different at the end of the day. But how we deal with each other is the most important thing. And how we deal with each other, we take examples from the Prophet and the Ahlul Bayt. So science. Science has many things. It talks about the psychological state of someone when he's angry. It's said that he's lost the plot. Have you noticed when you say, oh, he's lost the plot, he's mad, he's angry now. Sometimes what you've got to do, you just got to leave him. Because he's angry. He's lost the plot, they say. Now Islamically, anger also has the same meaning. Islamically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created emotions such as happiness and grief and sadness. One of them is anger. It doesn't mean if someone's angry, it doesn't mean that it's a wrong thing. Bilakis, on the contrary, sometimes you have to be angry. You have to reach that mental state of anger for you to be able to defend yourself. In war, for example, especially within the Prophet's time, in war, they'd be angry for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for that, they'll be able to reach a certain level of energy in which they can defend themselves. Now, another thing which science says is that a human being, when he's normal and he's calm, he's using 1/10 of his full potential of energy, one-tenth of his full potential energy. However, when he becomes angry, he loses all of his features, and then he uses 10, this one-tenth is times by 10, so he uses his full energy when he's angry. That's why in war, they pump them up, because you need to use all of your energy. However, if it is used in a bad way, this full energy, imagine you're using 10 times worth of your normal energy on someone else. How do you think they're going to feel? So Islam says that you can be angry. It's fine to be angry. But make sure you have control over this emotion. The same thing with every other emotion. Love, happiness, sadness, grief, everything. You can have those features, but you have to have control over those features. Even love. Intense love is good, but sometimes you have to have control. Be angry, be sad, be grief, but you have to have control. The way you have control of your anger starts from a young age. Now, why does someone become angry in the first place? Someone insulted me, someone spoke about my family, someone spoke about my religion, someone's literally just annoying me. It's all in the mind. It's all about your ego. Someone's, I'm big and I'm a character and I have my responsibilities, I'm a big person. How can you say something about me like that? Therefore, I become angry. However, if you become humble and you lower yourself and you find humility, you can easily just say, okay, fine, you've said this about me. No problem, move on. I haven't taken this concern. It's fine. Smile to people. The most important thing is a smile. Have you noticed that if someone, with your friends or you go to a new place, if someone's constantly smiling, you automatically, it's a natural feeling, you automatically go towards them. If someone's, you don't really want to go next to him, do you? It's the same thing. Smile to people, even if they insult you, even if they talk about your parents and stuff. Oh, no, you have to show your... No, you don't. It's all in the mind. It's all about your ego. You don't have to use brute strength all the time. Use your mind. Have you noticed when someone's angry and he's shouting in your face, no, he's shouting in your face, suddenly you say to him, you smile in his face. How much more angrier does he become? How much more angry does he become? You know, it's because you're winning. This psychological thing about winning and losing. You're winning if you just open up your chest and smile at him. He knows. He knows that you can't do anything to him. He wants to provoke a response from you. He wants to say something. He wants you to move. He wants you to hit him so that he can hit you back. But no, if you just stand there, be patient, and you smile, he gets more angrier. Another thing is, patience is one of the most important issues with anger. Because anger with patience, anger, on the other side of it is patience. Of course, it does not feel right if someone insults your mother or your father or your family or your religion. If someone says something about Imam Ali alayhi salam, for example, if someone says about your religion or your mother, it doesn't feel good. It doesn't. You feel angry. But at the end of the day, if you stay patient within this, if you stay patient, you'll be able to overcome this. However, when does it start? It starts from a young age. If you teach this person from a young age to be patient, to be humble, to smile, to be a normal human being, then when he grows up, all of these issues, such as, friends and boys and him and my, I want to overcome him and I want to beat him and, having this thing of dressing nicely and dressing in a bad man kind of way, all this stuff, and he says something about my ends and his ends and my tradition and all this stuff. That becomes side, that becomes onto the side, that becomes just something as a phase. It's just a phase, it's just an amount of time until you can overcome it. But if you have the humbleness and the patience, then you're able to overcome this. Also, another thing is anger, when it comes to dealing with other people. Anger, when it comes to dealing with other people, it can become a sin. As in, if I feel angry about something and I hit someone for example, a parent, this becomes a sin, by the way. And I don't know if I should be telling this, but I'd tell you anyway. A parent, if he hits his child out of anger, and there is a mark left on his body, this child can seek compensation from the parent. As in, at the end of the day, everyone's now looking for places. Now, so what happens is the child, this is Islamically, of course, the child can seek compensation. As in, you know, it becomes a sin. It becomes a sin at the end of the day. Of course, I'm not telling you to all go to your parents, I want money for this, how much times you've hit me. No. What I'm saying is that there's a level of respect. There's a level of respect. Of course, when a father hits you, that's another issue. I'm not going to talk about whether or not mums and dads should hit their children. That's a totally other different subject. But it also comes into the issue of anger. Like I said, as children, from a young age, teach them to be humble, teach them to be patient. And inshallah, they grow up knowing that if they are angry, they can hold this emotion. They can let it go in a different way. Imam Ali alayhi salam, this is absolutely beautiful. Imam Ali alayhi salam, every time he was angry, how much did the world hurt Imam Ali? Imam Ali, he was living during a time where he used to say, I have the keys to the hereafter. I have the keys to knowledge that you don't even know about. I have everything in front of you. Ask me before you lose me, he said. Ask me any question that you have. And the stupidity at the time, the most knowledgeable question that they had was, how many hairs on my head? This is the kind of people that these Imam Ali had to live with. Along with that, all of the calamities that Imam Ali had to face, all of the calamities from his khilafah that they took from him, from his cousin that they killed, from Fatima Zahra that they killed, from Hassan, Hussein, every single calamity the world showed Imam Ali alayhi salam, not one day or not one occasion did he show that he was angry with anyone. Instead, what did he do? He went to the desert. He goes to the desert every single time he's angry. He has these emotions, which is fine. Even the infallible imams have emotions. But how did they show these emotions? He went to the desert, Imam Ali alayhi salam. He used to put his fist, he used to dig a hole, put his fist inside the sand and let all his emotions out. So Mother Nature takes all his anger. Mother Nature takes his anger. Not any other person can take his anger. Every single emotion that he feels, Imam Ali alayhi salam, he used to go to the desert, put his fist inside the ground, and let everything out. Goes back to normal, goes back to the people, normal. Calm and collective. The Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, not one day did they have peace. Not one day did they have peace. Even during the time of Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, when the universities were spreading and knowledge of the Shia was spreading, during the time of Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam, when he was the Amir, he was given a position of Amir, they would still be oppressed. Did they show one ounce of anger? Imam al-Hussein in the land of Karbala, an army of 72,000, did he show one ounce of anger? Sayyidah Zainab, when they asked her, how do you think of what we've done to your brother Hussein alayhi salam? What do you think of what we've done to your brother, when they asked Sayyidah Zainab? She says, I see nothing but beauty. Patience. I see nothing but beauty. She could have easily showed her emotions. Oh, I'm angry. But no. An example for all of us to take. Sayyidah Zainab, what kind of response can you give to someone who's killed your own brother? Someone who's killed your brother, your whole family, and you say, I see nothing but beauty. Patience. The Prophet, before he passed away, he mentioned a couple of things, but before I go into the Prophet, practical methods of how to overcome this anger. Believe it or not, if you're standing up and you're angry, sit down. If you're angry, sit down. If you're angry in a certain place, exit that building. Why? Because if you're in that same place and you see something which reminds you of why you're angry, you will still be even more angry. If you're angry and you're in a room, leave that room. Leave that room, go somewhere else. Find fresh air. If you're standing up, sit down. Very simple. If you're sitting down and you're angry, stand up and leave the place. Leave the place before it becomes too late. Why? Because Imam Ali alayhi salam says, at the time of anger, you're enraged, but at the end of it, it becomes regret. You regret everything that you've done. Again, how many times when your parents have hit you, they also come back to you and say, you know, I'm sorry for hitting you. Or, you know, me personally as a child, I used to always go to one of my parents after they've hit me. And I tell them, you know, Mom, why did you hit me? She says, no, I'm sorry. I got angry. I'm sorry. They feel regret. The sin that happens is that you regret. At the time of when you're angry, you lose focus, you lose everything in your mind, you don't see anything, but after that you always feel regret. You know, I'm sorry for doing this. You kiss the person's head, for example. You know, I've seen, for example, when there's arguments here, especially in this center, when there's arguments happen, at the end of the day, arguments happen, when they come back together, oh, I'm sorry. Again, it's a sign of humility, but I'm sorry for being angry, I'm sorry for what I said, So this is, if you have an anger issue, and if you do become angry after it, make sure you do apologize. Because again, with the story about the nail and the hammer and the fence, you leave a hole inside this person. You leave a hole, you've really hurt him. So make sure you do, if you have become angry with someone, and you know you've become angry and you've said something, or you've said something out of reason, or you've hit him, you come back to him and say, listen, I'm sorry. Why? Because then your relationship will become better. Because he knows that you're a humble person, you're a patient person. The Prophet, before he passed away, he said one of the most important lines within Shia faith and within the whole of the Muslim world as well. He said, Fatima is a part of me. Fatima is a part of me. Whoever hurts her has hurt me. Whoever hurts me has hurt Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What a line. What a line. Fatima is a part of me means that her blood, her flesh, her mind, her eyes, her ears, her lungs, her heart, everything to do with Fatima Zahra is in the Prophet. How much do the Muslims, our dear brothers, take the Prophet as a leader and a guide? Then Fatima is also their leader and their guide. Fatima is a part of me. Whoever angers Fatima has angered me. How many people angered Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam during her lifetime, even after her death? Why is it, and this is a question that we take, inshallah, to the grave, why is it that Fatima al-Zahra was not able to be buried in daylight? Why is it that we can't see her grave? Why is it that millions of people go to her son year in, year out? Year in, year out, we go to the shrine of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, but we don't know where the grave of Fatima is. Why? Of course, if I'm going to enter this discussion, it'll take me a very, very, very long time. But from what we know, the companions that were around Rasulullah, those dear companions that loved Rasulullah, did not take into consideration this hadith, Fatima is a part of me, whoever hurts her, hurts me. And they did what they did. And they did what they did to Fatima to Zahra. They crushed her between the wall and door. After she passed away, Imam Ali now had to take care of the janazah. Of course, it was in the midst of the night. No one was around but her family. No one was around but her family. So Imam Ali alayhi salam, he takes the body, he takes the kafan, and he looks to his left and he sees Hassan, Hussein, Sayyidah Zainab, Umm Kulthum, and a couple of other Bani Hashim members, silently weeping, silently crying. As Imam Ali alayhi salam is wrapping Fatima to Zahra, the last knot of the kafan, he turns to his sons and his daughters, he says, Hassan and Hussein, Zainab and Umm al-Kulthum, come and bid farewell to your mother, Zahra. Come and say your last words to Zahra, your mother. Hassan comes first, then Hussein. They immediately run to the chest of Fatima. They say, wa Ummah, wa
from the skies. Jibreel says to Imam Ali, take Hassan and Hussein away from Zahra, for the angels can't bear to see this sight. Oh Ali, take Zainab, for the angels can't bear to see Zainab cry. The angels can't bear to see Hussein cry. The angels can't bear to see Hassan cry. But instead, Imam Ali sits in a corner and cries. The servant asks Imam Ali, why do you cry? You are the hero of Khaybar. You are the husband of Fatima to Zahra. Where is your courage, O Ali? Imam Ali replies, as I was washing the body of Fatima, I washed over the body and I reached the ribs of Fatima to Zahra. Each rib was broken by the wall and door, and therefore I sit in a corner and cry. But our cries, O Shia, are to Imam Sahib al-Asri wa al-Zaman. We ask him, O Imam, when will you return? When will you return and show us the way to Fatima's grave? Millions visit your dear son, Imam al-Hussein. Millions visit your grandfather, Imam al-Hussein. But there is no light to show us where the grave of Fatima is. There is no light to show us where the grave of Fatima is. All we want to do is kiss that shrine. We want to see our needs with Fatima. وإنا إليه راجعون وسيعلم الذين ظلموا آل محمد أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك. عليكم مني جميعا سلام الله. أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين، خصوصا سيدي ومولاي بالفضل العباس واخته زينب جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. Brothers and sisters, please raise your hands for the dua, inshallah. إلهي بمريض كربلاء زين العابدين يا رب، عافي وشافي جميع المرضى على خصم الأوصانا بالدعاء يا الله. إلهي ارزقنا في الدنيا زيارة الحسين وفي الآخرة شفاعة الحسين يا الله. اللهم وفقنا لمراضيك، جنبنا معاصيك، اجعل عواقب أمورنا خيرا يا الله.